your power and your majesty. Hold on. You rule and reign in victory. Hold on. Great and mighty is your name. Oh God. Heaven and earth proclaim. Hold on. Your power and your
strong and mighty, who is Faces with bright, shiny faces. That's a good thing. That's a good thing. God has been good to us. He has allowed us to assemble here once again to praise his holy name and to give him thanks for what he has done for us, is doing, and what he will do for us. Again, we say welcome this morning. Today is the day that the Lord has made, so we will rejoice and we will be glad in it. Because God didn't have to wake you up this morning. He didn't have to start you on this way. Despite our evil and wicked ways, he did it anyway. Because he's God and he's God all by himself. Welcome to the worship service this morning. We come to have a great day in the Lord and to give him praise and honor for all that he does for us each and every day. Praise the Lord. Let's give him a hand clap of praise this morning. Thank you, thank you. There are a few announcements I would like to bring to your attention this morning. And Exploring We Will Go has resumed activities on Saturday morning at 9 a.m. So keep that in your calendar and keep that on your forefront of your mind that this has been resumed and is back in action once again. Church Street family, you are invited to join the 2024 Black History Month Committee. Please contact Sister Allison Young for more information. All you all that have that talent out there that you're sitting on, I know you got it. Just come up and just let it be used for God's benefit and for the glory of the Lord. So if anybody that's interested in this and would like to be a part of it, contact Sister Allison Young. All right. We also are preparing this year for our church anniversary, so we're revving that up. There are several activities that are coming forth, so be mindful of those and be prepared to participate. Sister Rita Carr, you said you had an announcement you would like to make this morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Again, I wanted to just mention that Sleep in Heaven and Peace Ministry is still ongoing. There are several ways that you can get involved. First, there's a community build. Well, it's actually two of them. One is on February 17th, and the other one is on the 23rd. And those are opportunities for us to go and participate with other individuals across the community in building beds to take to kids around the community. I had an opportunity yesterday to go and with a couple who were delivering a bed, actually two beds, to a family in North Huntsville, and it was a very rewarding experience. One person could do it by themselves, but to go and have and help with that, they have tools and stuff, so everything is really organized, and it was just like a well-oiled machine. It took only maybe an hour to set up two beds. But it was very rewarding. The family that we gave the beds to were very appreciative of that. So that's a way that you can also get involved as well. If you have time and want to go with some other people who are involved in Sleep in Heavenly Peace and actually deliver the beds to families. We set up the bed, we put the bedding on, and we actually gave them stuffed animals also. So it was really nice. Also, if you... as you know, we're hosting a bed bill, Church Street bed bill, and partnering with Fellowship Presbyterian Church. And that is April 20th. And we're targeting being able to make at least 30 beds, and that's around $7,500. I think that may be wrong. But anyway, we're asking individuals, groups in the church, choirs, Sunday school classes, whoever would like to donate money towards that, you can do it through the church and earmark it for Sleep in Heavenly Peace, and all that money would go towards that, the money that we would need to buy the materials for the beds that we're going to build. If the weather is permitting, it would be here on site in the parking lot. And we're needing everyone that would like to get involved in that to do that. But if you're interested in doing the community build with other people within the community, that's just going and you know, maybe you be over the sanding or over the sawing or the drilling, or there's so many, the staining of the wood, there's so many different things that you could do. You don't need any type of experience, but if you would like to get involved with that, you can see me after church. Again, those dates are February 17th and March 23rd, if you would like to get involved along with other people in the community. But if you have any questions, feel free to contact me. Thank you.
Amen. Amen. I also want to ask that we keep our pastor in prayer. He's having a little illness, a little time that he's going through at this particular point. Nothing to be really over concerned about, but keep him in your prayers. He's a hardworking man. He does a lot for all of us, and it would be nice if we can show up for him and show him just how much we love and appreciate him by keeping him and his family in prayer as he deals with his current situation. Also, we're asking for prayer for Minister Vanessa Simpson, who works with the Helping Hands Outreach Ministry. She had knee replacement surgery in December, and also during that period of time, she lost her father. So keep her in prayer as well. Brother Aubrey Parker and his family and his current situation with his sister Kimberly Pace. Reverend Cedric Pollard lost his mother, Emily Pollard, and she was funeralized yesterday in Bessemer. So also keep him in your prayers as well, and keep him lifted up, and do whatever you can to support the family as well. Sister Teresa Ander and Dr. Deborah Matthews, in the passing of two cousins, Mr. Thomas Arthur Bishop and Mr. J. Banks of Conyers, Georgia. Now we will have a couple of young men that are very energetic and working in this church to bring to come up and recognize the birthday and wedding anniversary. Mr. Brother Johnny Redrick and Brother Jamie Redrick. Thank you.
Good morning. Today we will have our first 2024 anniversary and birthday recognition for the months of January and February. If you are celebrating an anniversary in January and February, please stand and wave your hand. Trust in God's plan for your relationship as you step into another year of marriage. Happy anniversary. Why are January birthdays special? Because while the rest of the world is busy trying and failing to stick to their New Year's resolutions, January babies are celebrating a fresh new year of life. They're the silver lining on the coldest days, the ones who bring warmth amidst the frost. And honestly, January birthdays are like that first sip of hot cocoa after coming inside from a chilly day. All January birthdays, please stand. May your cup overflow with blessings and joy on your special day, and always, happy birthday.
Amen. Go ahead.
Congratulations. February is a great month to be born. Science says so. For starters, being born this month is actually rather rare, statistically speaking, as February is the shortest month of the year. However, this year, there's one more day, February 29th. Having a birthday in February, like me, is pretty cool. Let's take a look at some things as some other ways February birthdays are special. February babies are taller, stronger, and smarter. February babies are pretty chilled out. Why? Because studies show that people born in colder months less irritable and are less prone to mood swings than summer-born peers. And we get to share our birthdays with some pretty special events. Black History Month, Groundhog Day. Did the groundhog see its shadow? The Grammys, the Super Bowl, NBA All-Star Game, Valentine's Day, President's Day, and Mardi Gras. I told you February is a great month to be born. Would all February birthdays please stand or wave your hand? May God's grace and love be your guiding light today and always. Happy birthday.
Will all January and February birthdays stand for a birthday song? Please.
Come on, there's no good time to be ashamed. Such a wonderful thing to celebrate an anniversary or birthday rather than saying they would have been or if they had to live this long. But thank God for each day that He gives us. And let us understand that we need to take advantage of each day rather than walking around pouting, being sad and upset, but knowing that God is in control. Everything's going to be all right as long as you keep your hand in the Master's hand. He has it all under control. So all we need to do is just follow His lead and do what He tells us to do, and He will do what He said He will do. That you can take it to the bank. Also, it was something else I wanted to say, but hey, we'll let that slide by right now. Thank you. I will not tell you all to get up and tell your birthday age. That's your own business. So we'll leave that to yourself. May we bow for a word of prayer. Gracious Father, we thank You, Lord, for this day. We thank You for allowing us to assemble here one with the other. Father God, we pray that You will be pleased with what we do here today, and may all that we do bring glory and honor to You. Help us to understand, Father, without You there is no us. And Lord, we just want to say thank You for allowing us to have another day on this earth so that we may perform the duties that You have called us to do. And may all that we do bring glory and honor to You. For, Lord, these things we do ask and pray in Thy Son Jesus' name with thanksgiving. Amen. Amen. Our opening congregational hymn this morning is Lift Every Voice and Sing. So we need your voices this morning.
Thank you.
think about Black History Month, I talk to you about people talking about taking books off the shelves and trying to squash our history. But most of all, that are in this room, we are Black history. We understand the struggle. We've been through those things. I remember growing up and going to my grandmother's house, and the Freedom Riders came through, and they would meet at the church. And so it's an organized effort. And we're continuing today to continue to fight for those things that are just and fair. But one thing we do have, and that's hope and trust in our God. When you look back over your life and you see where you have come from and where you are today, it's only through God's power and strength have you made it. You didn't pull yourself up by your own bootstraps. You didn't make your own way. God made the way. You followed the path. So we have a right to be a proud group of people that have fought hard throughout our lives. But not only us, but there's others that have suffered outside of the race of the Black people. So we're all in this fight together, and we all must struggle to win the fight, because God is still in control. Amen? Amen. Oh, now see what my collective memory comes back. Now I remember what I wanted to tell you. Valentine's Day. The annual Valentine's Day luncheon, save this date, February the 14th, 2024, from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m., Church Street CPA Fellowship Hall. Sign up today in the main hall, hosted by the Senior Care Ministry team. So you all get all your little good stuff together, all your flowers and your roses and your candy and your sweethearts, and let them know how much you really appreciate them. And every day should be a day of Valentine's, should be a day of celebration for the ones that love us and we love in return. Our scripture reading this morning, all right, our scripture reading this morning will be coming out of the Old Testament lesson, the book of Psalms 47, verses 1 through 11, and 20C out of the NIV version of the Bible. Praise the Lord. How good it is to sing praises to our God. How pleasant and fitting to praise Him. The Lord builds up Jerusalem. He gathers the exiles of Israel. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. He determines the number of the stars and calls them each by name. Great is our Lord and mighty in power. His understanding has no limit. The Lord sustains the humble but casts the wicked to the ground. Sing to the Lord with grateful praise. Make music to our God on the harp. He covers the skies with clouds. He supplies the earth and rain and make grass grow on the hills. He provides food for the cattle and for the young ravens when they call. His pleasure is not in the strength of the horse, nor his delight in the legs of the warrior. The Lord delights in those who fear him, who put their hope in his unfailing love. Praise the Lord. Amen. Our New Testament scripture reading will be coming out of the book of Mark. Mark, the first chapter, verses 4 through 11, the NIV version of the Bible. As soon as they left the synagogue, they went with James and John to the home of Simon and Andrew. Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they immediately told Jesus about her. So he went to her, took her hand, and helped her up. The fever left her, and she began to wait on them. That evening and after sunset, the people brought to Jesus all the sick and demon-possessed. The whole town gathered at the door. And Jesus healed many who had various diseases. He also drove out many demons, but he would not let the demons speak because they knew who he was. Very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. Simon and his companions went to look for him, and when they found him, they exclaimed, "Everyone is looking for you." Jesus replied, "Let us go somewhere else, to the nearby villages, so I can preach there also. That is why I have come." So he traveled throughout Galilee, preaching in their synagogues and driving out demons. Amen. Now, it's an opportunity for you to participate one more time. Our affirmation of faith. And you remember, if you please stand and read that, and read it with your whole heart, your whole mind, your whole strength, and your whole spirit. We don't want to disappoint Pastor. He told us that we should read it with energy and with power and with conviction. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into the heavens and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Amen. Thank you for your joyful and delightful Apostles' Creed. Thank you. Praise the Lord. Now it's an opportunity for us to be able to give back a portion of that which God has given to us. God said he loves a cheerful giver. There are several ways that you can give to this ministry here at Church Street. There are a couple of boxes here for your tithes and offerings here. You can place them there. Giveify is one of the methods that we use, PayPal, online banking, and also you can send a check, a money order, how would you like, or you can drop it here by the church. But we just want you to be able to have an opportunity to give back to God a portion of that which he has given to you. God has been gracious to us. He's been more than fair with us. Things that we should have, he has given us. Things we should not have, he has kept away from us. So just give as your heart is led to give. Don't give reluctantly, but give compassionately and with a willing spirit. Amen. All right, we will have a musical selection at this time by the Chancellor Choir.
Sign me up for the Christian Jubilee.
It's a glorious day in the Lord. Thank God that he's taking care of us one more day. At this particular time, we will have a Black History moment, a moment in Black History, by Sister Allison Young.
Take a walk with me. Take a walk with me this first Sunday of Black History Month as we celebrate African Americans and the arts. Just take a short walk with me as we reflect and honor our past, present, and future African Americans and the arts. As you walk with me, can't you hear the voice of Sister Brenda Oliver singing "Order My Steps"?
All right.
Order my steps in your word. Lead me, guide me. You know, that song was written in 1991 by an African-American composer, Glenn Edward Burley. Take a walk with me. Can't you hear the vibrant sounds, the powerful sounds of that organ? You remember in an old church, it was on that corner over there? Played by our notable musicians, Mrs. Dorothy Turner. What about Mr. Tucker? Dr. Bradford? Take a walk with me, church. Do you know the name Miles Minashada? He is a 10-year-old African-American photographer. 10. He's from the Washington area, and he calls himself the first Black young professional photographer. He has taken photographs in the DC area for the DC racial protests and New York Fashion Week and several other events. But this young man is paving the way for our future photographers, much like Jamin Redrick, who happens to be an aspiring photographer, an aspiring musician, an artist. So now history dated in 1798 tells us that Joshua Johnson is the earliest documented African-American painter. History also tells us that Aaron Douglas is known as the father of African-American art. But history and the present also tells us that we have several artists here in Church Street. Jerica Kinlaw, Stacy Hart, Sarai Wheaton, just to name a few. Okay, now we have to stop for a moment. Let's talk about the art of cooking. And yes, I said art.
All right.
Because not many of us can cook. There is definitely an art to it. Don't you just love those Sunday fellowship dinners? Isn't the food good? And the lemonade and tea. Oh, it's just this special drink. Isn't it just so good? Well, you know it's so good because we have it prepared and catered by our own Elder Patton.
Amen.
And I cannot forget about the delicious pound cake made by Sister Janice Harrod Wilson. While we've stopped, I want you to turn to your neighbor. You know what we used to. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, you look good. Now take these last few steps with me because we might be getting a little tired. Take these last few steps with me as we make our way to the finish line. And I want you to just hear about this young lady. She was born in rural Alabama in 1898. She was the granddaughter of slaves. She learned how to sew and make clothes from her mother and her grandmother. Her name, Anne Love, is considered the first well-known African-American fashion designer. Church, I thank you for taking a short walk with me. I ask you to walk with us next Sunday. You can come dressed in your black, red, green, yellow attire. On the third Sunday, you can come dressed in your old-fashioned Sunday's best.
All right.
And then on the fourth Sunday, as we bring our whole celebration, but it won't stop, we'll carry it on throughout the year, to a close for this month, please feel free to walk with us and wear your favorite, your best African attire. Church, again, I say thank you for taking a walk with me, a short walk with me. I ask that you walk with me every Sunday this month as we reflect, honor, and celebrate our past, present, and future African Americans and the arts.
We must remember that we are somebody. We are not no mistake. We are not a joke. We are for real. We are God's people, and we have a purpose here on this earth. And every day you live below your purpose, you're not living to the fullness that God has called you to be. So every day we should strive to be better, to do better, so we can become all that He has designed for us to be. All right, we have one more musical selection by the Chancellor Choir, and then we will have the word from the Lord. Amen.
Come to die.
Trouble, who do I call on? Jesus. When I need a provision, who do I call on? Jesus. When I need to be uplifted, who do I call on? Jesus. The best thing my parents ever did for me, even when I don't understand and they had to drag me to church and I was going kicking and screaming, was to introduce me to Jesus. And that I thank them for, even when I didn't know who he was, what he was all about, when I didn't have no understanding. And as life began to unfold, and as I began to mature and become older, then I began to understand what Jesus means in my life. Had not I had that firm foundation when I left home to come here to college, I would have been lost. I wouldn't have not known who to call on when trouble arise. I would not have known when I was crossing the line. I would not have known that I wasn't all that in a bag of chips. I had to know that I'm only here because of the grace and the mercy of God. Because if any of us confess, none of us are worth a dime anyway. Not on, I don't know about y'all. I'm not without Jesus. And as Mother Cain would always say in Bible study, we don't have Bible study, it's confession time. And see, we talk about how we fall short of the glory of God. We don't play pretense with God. See, you think you can get up before God and say, well, Lord, I'm not going to say this in the prayer, and Lord, I'm not going to let you know this. God knows everything. The best thing you can ever do is come clean with Jesus. Let him know that you fall short. Let him know that you need his help. Let him know that without him, you wouldn't make it. Today in Sunday school, we were talking about things that we have come through, that God has brought us through, ways that we never thought that we would be delivered, but God is faithful. Even when we are unfaithful, he's still faithful. God doesn't get tired of us. We get tired of God. So when we get tired of hearing our parents telling us the right things to do, and they always on me, and they always, well, I don't think I can ever make it, but it's the best thing that ever happened to me. But because it calls me to seek Jesus, and it calls me to strive toward the mark of the higher calling. All of us have gifts. All of us have purpose in this world. God doesn't make junk. The things that you think have no value are more valuable to him than you think they are. But God is good. There is a word from the Lord this morning, and I pray that you'll be blessed as well as I was blessed to study this word. We will be coming out of the book of Peter, 2 Peter, verses 1 through 11, out of the NIV version of the Bible. 2 Peter, first chapter, verses 1 through 11. Simon Peter, a servant and apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who through the righteousness of our God and Savior Jesus Christ have received a faith as precious as ours. Grace and peace be yours in abundance through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. His divine power has given us everything we need for a godly life through our knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and goodness. Through these, he has given us his very great and precious promises, so that through them you may participate in the divine nature, having escaped the corruption in the world caused by the evil desires. For this very reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, and in goodness, knowledge, and to knowledge, self-control, and to self-control, perseverance, and to perseverance, godliness, and to godliness, mutual affection, and to mutual affection, love. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measures, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But whoever does not have them is nearsighted and blind, forgetting that they have been cleansed from their past sins. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, make every effort to confirm your calling and election. For if you do these things, you will never stumble, and you will receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We'd like to use for a subject this morning, building blocks for faith and salvation. Building blocks for faith and salvation. Father God, we thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to preach and teach your word. Father God, we pray that it be less of me and more of you. We pray that your Holy Spirit will give to these that are in this audience today the word that they need to sustain their efforts in continuing to follow you. Father God, without knowledge of you, Lord, we will perish. Lord, we just want to thank you for this opportunity to increase our faith and to give you glory and honor in all that we do. For, Lord, these things we ask and pray in thy Son Jesus' name with thanksgiving. Amen. Notice in the first verse there it says, Simon Peter, a servant and apostle of Jesus Christ. Do you know that we are all servants? We're all called to serve. We doesn't have to be from this pulpit. Doesn't have to be in the choir stand. Doesn't have to be on the usher board. It could be in the things you do in your life on a daily basis, at your job, at your house, at the community center, at the grocery store, wherever you are, the restaurants. You always need to exhibit Jesus Christ. When he's talking about being a slave, he's talking in the Old Testament, they talk about a bond servant. He said, if you want to be great, he said, become a bond servant. And a bond servant means that I give up all my rights for the rights of the person that I serve. And what we have to do is give up all our rights, all our desires for what Christ wants for us to do. I was thinking about this week, and I had a plan. I was planning to go to Birmingham and fellowship with a friend of mine, but for some reason or another, I got lazy and lethargic. And I thought I was just saying, boy, you know you could go down there and do better. But then God had a plan, because Friday night I got a call from the pastor. Now, I could have been down in Birmingham celebrating, relaxing, enjoying my family and my friend, but I just felt lethargic and didn't want to go. And the pastor called me and he said, I'm not feeling well. He said, can you preach for me Sunday? I said, yes, pastor, no problem. But I had already made a commitment to teach Sunday school. And I said, Lord, you kind of loading up on me, aren't you here? Then as I continued to talk to the pastor, he said, well, you know it's the first Sunday. I said, wow. That means I'm going to have to be the litigious too. Well, you know we got the Lord's Supper. I said, wow. Lord's Supper. Woo, Lord, you must really think a lot of me. He said, don't worry, I wouldn't have called your name if I knew that you weren't able to do what I called you to do. So I do not stand here in my own spirit, in my own power. I stand here because of the power of God that lives in me. We just got to learn how to surrender our will to God's will. We are ambassadors. We're God's workmanship. We were created for good works that had already been preordained before you were even born into this world. God had a plan for your life. Well, Lord, you got a plan, and I got a plan. But whose plan is going to trump my plan? God's plan always trumps our plan. So we are his servants. We're called to do what he has called us to do. And he says, equipped us to do it. He said, grace and peace be yours in abundance. Grace, unmerited favor. We have it in an abundance. We have peace with God because of the shed blood of Jesus Christ. His wrath has been settled because of Jesus coming and sacrificing his life for the sins that we have committed, past, present, and future. So we have peace with God. We're not an enemy of God. We have peace with him because of Jesus Christ. His divine power has given us everything we need for godly life and for knowledge of him who called us. Well, what is a godly life? Is it holding my hands like this when I pray? Is it speaking so correctly and dynamically, and I know the Lord and he has been good to me? Or is it putting on the character, the nature, the integrity of God? How can you say you represent God but act like a heathen? How can you be godly in one incident and ungodly in another? We need to develop some consistency. We need to get on a path that leads us in the godliness direction of God. He said, though these, he has given us every great and precious promise, so that through them they may participate in the divine nature. What promises did God give us? What did he say? Everlasting life, provision, healing, protection. There's numerous things that God gives us each and every day. And we got to understand that you didn't wake up yourself this morning. You thought the alarm clock was got you up? It's God that woke us up this morning. And he's the one that started us on our way. So what's your plan today? Is it to leave out this church and then forget everything you've heard here today? Or is it to internalize what God is saying and make it a part of your life? Something that would represent him, that would make him proud. You know, we all want to make our parents proud. We all want to make our teachers proud, our spouses, our children. But most of all, we should want to make Jesus proud of the fact that we have knowledge of who he is. He says, for this very reason, he said, make every effort to add your faith goodness. In the book of Corinthians, 1 Corinthians, 3rd chapter, it talks about Paul and Apollos. He talks about the people, say, one like Paul, and he said, one like Apollos. But who is Paul and Apollos but a workers of God? He said, one planted, the other water. He said, but I, God, give the increase. He said, you can't find no other foundation other than the foundation that was laid by Paul himself, by Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is our foundation. Our faith is what we must build upon. Our faith is in Jesus Christ. That is the foundation. But he said we got to add goodness to it. So what is goodness? It's morality, it's character, it's virtues. How do you treat people that irritate you? How do you treat people that say bad things about you? How do you sit and listen to the rhetoric that we hear coming out of Washington and out of other people's mouths? Does it line up with the word of God? Does this sound like the character or the nature of God? You can pretty much tell someone has a godly attitude by having a conversation with them. You know, I sit there and I look at the war over in Israel and Gaza. And man, we look and see the devastation there. And I said, I wonder, I said, Lord, what if it had been America? What if it had been my hometown that was being bombed? What if it was me that had to be displaced? So many times we forget about having compassion for others because God has protected us and provided for us. How many times we forget what God has done for us and we hadn't even tried to do half of the things he told us to do? He said, now I'm going to give you some. These are building blocks. You started with your faith. Then you got to add a godly attitude. You got to have the character, the nature, the integrity of God. And that's being compassionate, love, peace, joy, patience, kindness, faithfulness, goodness. How can I be good unless Christ resides in me? Because there's nothing good in this flesh at all. The flesh is at war with God. It is what fights against him on a daily basis. Even Paul himself said, things I should do, I don't do. Things that I should not do, I find myself doing. Don't think because you just walked up here and you gave your life to Jesus Christ that everything is going to be all right. Hey, boy, the war is just beginning. And I tell you what, the closer you get to him, the more intense the warfare is going to be. So you got to make sure that your building is built on a solid foundation. He said, into knowledge. You got to have a knowledge of who Christ is. Most of the reason that none of us can't witness is because we don't really know who God is for us ourselves. How can you tell somebody about somebody that you don't know anything about? So I got to get knowledge. I got to spend time with him. Man, and you know, prayer is hard. you find yourself, I used to wonder when the old saying, you say, all day long I've been with Jesus. And I said, how you can be with Jesus all day long? But I found out how you can do it. Yes, sir. When the morning comes, I can get up and I can petition him in the morning. I can petition him throughout the day. I can tell him, thank you that that car didn't run over me. I can say, thank you, Lord, that that little dog that ran in the middle of the street, that I didn't run over him. I can see somebody sleeping on the street and have compassion for them and thank God for the bed that I have to sleep in. So many times we look at other people and turn our nose up and wonder why they're like that, but we never think about what can I do to help solve the problem. So many times we pass by people that need what you have, but we're too afraid to get involved because we don't think it's our business. But our business is the Father's business. Our business is to encourage people, to uplift them, to show them that there is a better way. Now, I'm like Paul. I was a chief son, and I did it well. Boy, I had a ball. I lived like I wanted to live. Went to bed when I wanted to go to bed, got up. I just couldn't wait to get out of my mama and daddy's house so I could do everything they told me not to do. And boy, did I do it. I did it well. But the strength and the power that he gave me is the same strength and power that I have to stand here and proclaim the gospel and the good news of Jesus Christ. So I had to keep building. I had to keep growing. You know, you said, man, I wonder, would they ever stop talking about Sunday school? Would they ever stop talking about Bible study and talking about prayer? Lord, I just pray, pray, pray. I need knee pads. Lord, I'm down here all the time. But you don't necessarily have to be on your knees all the time. Sometimes you don't have time to get on your knees. Sometimes you don't have time to get in that godly position that you think God recognized. All you got to do is say, help! Lord, I need you, and I need you right now. And God is an ever-present help in a time of trouble. He said, I'll never leave you, nor will I forsake you. Sometimes I think that, Lord, am I there by myself? Then I have to remember that, Lord, you are in control. And, Lord, I'm where I am today because of your grace and your mercy, your unmerited favor. And I'm here standing today trying to grow and to be better. I got to get knowledge. And the only way I'm going to get knowledge is to read the Bible, to study, and to interact with other people. A lot of times when we're standing in a group together, somebody might say something that illuminates a piece of scripture that you never, ever thought about. God didn't give all the answers to me. He gave some of the answers to you, too. And as I continue to grow in Christ, I got to understand that if I have no knowledge of him, how can I talk about something I don't know? Trials and tribulations. God said, you want patience? I remember somebody said, man, I need more patience. He said, okay, then God said, I'm going to give you a few more trials. That's how you develop patience, through trials and tribulations. You learn how to wait on the Lord. Learn how to renew your strength. We were talking today in Sunday school. He said the young get weary and they get tired because they can't do it in their own strength. And you can't either. So I need the Holy Spirit that dwells inside of me. Once I gave my life to Christ, and you did too, he made a deposit in you, and it was the Holy Spirit. You know that little sound, that little voice that speaks to you all the time, and you be talking about, I wonder where that came from. When I got my call in the ministry, I thought I had lost my mind. I was sitting up there, and God said, preach my word. I said, ooh, that's a heck of a thought. Where did that come from? But see, we think God comes in all these grand vestures and all these grand overtures, but God doesn't have to holler. All you got to do is speak in a quiet, soft voice. Don't go there. Stay away from here. Go here. go that way. Well, Lord, that doesn't make sense. God said, quit trying to make sense of this. You'll never make sense of me. Just like in the case of Job. And God tells us the same way. He said, have you tried my servant Fred? Have you tried my servant Rebel Devil? Have you tried this servant and that servant? Trust me, you're not going to get into heaven unless you pass these tests. I mean, see, the trials and tribulations of life are the test to see whether you have the faith to trust and wait on God to put everything in position. Then he said that self-control. Whew. Me and Mother Cain talk about this all the time. I remember the day when I wouldn't give you a chance to get all the words out your mouth. I would set you down. And self-control doesn't necessarily have to do with your mouth. It could be the lust of the flesh, the desires of the world, the possessions, the things that you think that's going to bring you happiness. If I could just reach this goal in this job, if I could just get this car, if I can get this house, those are the things that distract you from God. You find yourself pursuing them more than you pursue God, who makes it possible for you to get these things. Then I got to keep building, and I got to persevere. Think about all the things that you've been through, the surgeries, the disappointments, the loss of a loved one, the loss of a job, the loss of a spouse, and think about how you have to persevere, how God has brought you through when you didn't think you were going to make it, how God was there when you were at your worst end, when your friends couldn't help you. Only God and God alone. And see, trials come to make you strong. Then he said, you will mount up like the wings of eagle. He said, you run and not be weary, and you walk and not faint. You see, if I'm trusting God, if my hope is in him, then I can mount up like the wings of eagle. You know what an eagle does? An eagle, when the storm comes, he flies above the storm. And then after he flaps so many times, he just soars. He just flies on the wing. He just glides through the air. Isn't it good to know that I can just soar with God, that this too shall pass, that the things that I'm going through, the things that we're dealing with, boy, we're in a tough situation in this world today. God is testing us to see who is truly his children. We had the coronavirus. We got the Trump virus. We got the Black History virus. We got the woke virus. We've been attacked on all sides. But then I know that God allows things to happen to see who you're going to run to and put your trust in. It's only a test. It's only a test of your faith to see if you really do trust God. It's easy to say you trust him until those situations get on your doorstep. It's easy to tell somebody, I'm going to pray for you and God bless you and I hope you feel better, until the shoe is on your foot. And so many times we need to put ourselves in the place of others. We need to have compassionate love for one another. And this stuff that they're trying to put out here now, this Rachel, and then they're trying to use the scripture. See, if you didn't read the scriptures and know who truly God is, you know that that rhetoric they talk about, that doesn't come from God. God's not like that. That's not God's character. That's not God's nature. How can God tell you to keep somebody from coming in the country when you're an immigrant yourself? How can you take food away from children because you don't like the policies of someone sitting in that office? You got states that right now have rejected the food summer program because they don't like the policies of this man that's sitting in the White House. Why do they have to suffer because of your selfishness? It's nothing but power-hungry, selfish people that are trying to put you back in what they call your place. They try to make you feel like you have no value. I told you earlier that God doesn't make junk. Everything he makes has value. So you can't let other people determine your worth and your value. So now when people talk about me, you know, I got to have self-control. I got to be able to love them despite the fact that they are persecuting me. Just think what they did to Jesus. They hung him on the cross, and he hadn't done not one thing. So why do you think it's strange when you find yourself in fiery temptation? These only come to test your faith, to make sure. So I got to grow in the knowledge. I got to understand that this is spiritual warfare. You can't go up there and punch this out or kick it out or cut it out or shoot it up. We're in spiritual warfare, and you got to meet the spirit with the word of God. So now he said to perseverance, godliness, and to godliness, mutual affection, and mutual affection means love. I got to love my enemies. Even though they're trying to persecute me, even though they talk bad of me, I still have to love them. And like I said, I found that out in the employment that God gave me throughout my life. I said every position I put in, I was everything but what my mama named me. As a basketball official, I had no eyesight. I didn't know what I was doing. I was crazy. And when I was young in officiating, you know, I was like this. You know, the hood came out of me. The streets came out. I'm out there with this striped shirt on. I'm supposed to honor the profession of the Officials Association. But somebody said something to me. The first thing I wanted to do was pull my shirt off. You know how we say, lay our religion down. Pull my shirt out there and go and give them a piece of my mind and then come back and officiate. But God said, we don't operate like that. You got to learn how to control your emotions. You got to learn how to quit letting people needle you. And you got to know your limits. You got to know when you're about to blow up. You got to know when you're about to lose your mind. And that doesn't represent Christ at all. And so now I got to exercise self-control. But the reason I was able to do what I could do in my job and officiate is because I knew the rules. I studied. I got better. Are you getting better? Are you still where you were back when you was a kid? 15, 20 years ago, have you grown in Christ? Do you have more knowledge of who he is, or do you come out of here for shape, form, and fashion? Or do you come because your mother and father said you had to, and you're just trying to carry on the family tradition? You got to understand that you're going to have to give an account to God yourself. You're going to have to stand up there personally. It's not going to be a group effort. He's going to take one at a time. He's going to ask you, what did you do? And then Paul talks about in 1 Corinthians, he's talking about, what do you build on that foundation of faith? Whenever you see a tornado or a hurricane come through a community, only thing you see left is the foundation. That means you can build again. Even when you stumble and you fall, you can build again. God will forgive you of your sins. God will forgive you of your transgression. God is a forgiving, loving God. Quit trying to be perfect. You're not perfect. None of us are. There's nobody but one. And that's God himself. So many times we think perfection means 100 on the test. Or that line is straight. That's perfect. Man, put that flower there. That is just perfect. But perfection in the Bible talks about being mature. You'll never be perfect on this side. But guess what? You're made in the image of God, the likeness of him. He speaks like you do. He talks like you do. He walks. He does the same things that we do, except for we don't have that eternal body yet. But in order to get there, you got to finish the race. You remember when you could sit up here and you ask the question, how many of you all know you're going to heaven? What I've told you here today are things that means that you're working on that. And if you read down there in verse 9, it says, but whoever does not have them is nearsighted. You know, how it is? We don't look off into the future. We look at what's close to us. Yeah, man, I'm not worried about eternal life. I'm not worried about living forever. All I want to do is serve the flesh. I want to serve my selfish self. I want to get all I can get, and I want to enjoy all the life I can enjoy while I can, while I'm strong enough, young enough to do it, and bad enough, and then I'll come to Jesus and say, okay, Lord, I'm ready. It won't happen that way. Everybody won't have the conversion like the thief on the cross. Some of you think you can just hold out, and then all of a sudden you just come up there and say, okay, Lord, I'm ready. It doesn't work like that. Because God will say, get away from you, you workers of iniquity, for I knew you not. Well, what do you mean you don't know us, Lord? Didn't we do this and do this and do this and your name? No, you didn't really do it in my name. You did it for you to be glorified. But I'm the only person that should be glorified. He said, but whoever does not have these things are nearsighted and blind and forgetting the day that they have been cleansed from their past sin. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, make every effort to confirm your calling. Confirm. These things confirm your calling. When you take on the narrative, the nature, the character, the integrity, and the spirit of God. When you live in that, that confirms your calling. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, make every effort to confirm your calling and election, for if you do these things, you will never stumble, and you will receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. If you do these things, go back and read verses 5, and use this as a guide to see if you're growing in Christ, if you're working. I'm working. He said, work on your salvation in fear and trembling. You need to be working it out. And now's a good time to start. God is still in control. Building blocks for your faith and for your salvation. These things assure that you will see the Lord and that you will reign with him and that you will live with him forever and ever. Don't sell out for the things of this world. These things are going to be burned up. They're going to be gone. I was reading in the Sunday school lesson. It was talking about God's abode is above the earth. And I finally got the idea of what he means, that the earth is his footstool. God is so big. Until he said that I just use this to rest my feet on. That's awesome, isn't it? Think about it. Think about the price that he paid for you. And think about how you honor him by how you live your life. Think about making your election sure. So you'll be able to raise your hand and say, I know I'm going to heaven. And I know I'm going to spend my eternal life with Jesus Christ. I know I'm not all that. I know I make mistakes. I know I stumble, but yet and still he shall uphold me with his hand. He said, I've been young and I've been old, but never have I seen the righteous forsaken, nor their seed begging bread. Think about it. Think about your life. Think about where you are now. And where you want to spend the rest of your life. Amen? Amen. Amen. Now, maybe there's someone out there that's struggling today, trying to make it on their own. But I can tell you about somebody that's already paid the price so that you too may have eternal life. We're talking about a Savior that left heaven, lived on this earth. He was died, he was crucified, and he rose, and now he sits at the right hand of the Father, interceding on our behalf each and every day. Do not put your trust in the things of this world, nor the people of this world, but put your faith and your trust in God, and he will take you places that you never imagined. He's already protecting you even outside the will of God. God is not a God that he discriminates. The rain falls on the just and the unjust. But now is an opportunity for you to secure your place in heaven with Christ and do what you've been called to do. Is there one today, as the choir sing, is there one that would like to give their life to Christ? I didn't say it would be easy, but it's going to be better. It's the best decision you can ever make, is to put your trust and then learn how to grow in the knowledge and wisdom of Christ. On the night that our Lord and Savior was about to be apprehended, he met with his disciples in the upper room. It was called the Last Supper. He met with his followers. He took the bread and said, "This is my body, which has been broken for you. Eat it. And do this in remembrance of me." In like manner, after they had supped, he took the cup. He said, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood, which was shed for you for the remission of your sin. Drink this and do it in remembrance of me." For he said, "As often as you eat of this bread and drink of this cup, you do show the death of our Lord and Savior until he returns." We do not take this lightly because of the price that was paid for our salvation. Gracious Father, we thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to gather together as your children and to sup with you so that we can remember all the things that you have sacrificed and that you have done for us, Lord. For Lord, you know we're not worthy, but Lord, you thought that we were worth it, so you sent your son to die. Amen. Lord, we just want to give you glory and honor today, and we want to sup with you and let you know how much we appreciate all that you have done, are doing, and will do in our lives. Now, Father God, we just want to give you glory and honor for these things, Lord. We do ask and pray in thy son Jesus' name with thanksgiving. Amen. As you come up to receive your bread and your wine, those who are not able, will you let the ushers know, and they will make sure that you are served as well. We will start from the rear of the church, come to the outer walls, and come up and receive. Okay, we start at the back. Ushers start at the back. Thank you. right, has everyone been served? Good. We're on one accord. That's a good place to be. Gracious Father, this is your body which has been sacrificed for us and broken. Take and eat. This cup represents the blood of the new covenant. Drink. Now that we have renewed our covenant with God, let us leave this place better than when we came in. And may we take what we've learned here today and share it with others. And not only share it, but let us show it. Sometimes you don't get a chance to speak it, but just the way you treat people, the way you act, it exemplifies who God is. And they will know there's something different about you, and that you're not like everybody else in the world. Because we are a holy nation, a royal priesthood. We're a peculiar people. People don't understand us. How can we love somebody when they've spent so much hate out of us? Because God has commanded and empowered us to do so. And just think the rewards that we would reap for doing what God has called and told us to do. I pray that I get a chance to see all of you all in heaven. I'm looking forward to it. Now don't be surprised when you don't see some people that you thought would be there. And then when you see some people that you said, I never thought they would make. But you don't know who God can touch. And you don't know the power of God and what he can do. All right, let us stand together and pray. Grab someone's hand if you're not afraid to do so. We do respect everyone's rights in this building. So good to see some of our members back in church with us today, and Elder Wright and his wife. I see Brother Willie Powell is back with us, and some of those that have been out because of illnesses and surgeries. Say hello to them. Tell somebody you love them. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor,
neighbor,
I love you.
I love you.
Amen. Gracious Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day. We thank you for all you do. Lord, you've just been good to us, Lord, better than we could have ever been to ourselves. And Lord, we just want to say thank you. Father God, for looking over our faults and seeing our needs, for guiding and directing us and telling us right and left, wrong and right. Father God, we need you each and every day in our life. Because Lord, if we were left to ourselves, where would we be? We would be lost. We would have no way for to eternal life. Now, Father God, we are your workmanship. We are your hands. We are your ambassadors. We represent you. And Father God, give us a desire to know more about you so that we can be more proficient at what you called us to do. Let us not run off to find somebody to explain something to someone else. Let us be able to explain enough so that they would have a thirst and a lust for you. Father God, we're not all that we should be, for Lord, we're forever pressing toward the mark of the higher call. And may all that we do bring glory and honor to you. For Lord, it's not about us and it's all about you. And the only strength we have is the strength that is deposited in us by the Holy Spirit. Father God, we just want to give you glory today. We want to give you honor today. For Lord, you are worthy. You are worthy. You are worthy to be praised. Father God, you know everything. You know the moon, the sun, the moon, the stars. Everything in this world belongs to you. And Lord, we belong to you with our whole heart, our whole mind, our whole strength, our whole soul, and our whole spirit. Father God, I know we fall short, and I know we disappoint you, but Lord, thank you for grace and mercy that covers all our faults and all our inadequacies, Lord. We just want to say thank you. Now, as we leave this place, may we share the good news of the gospel with those we see. Not only in what we speak, but in how we live. Yes. And may we ever be mindful to give you the honor and the glory. For Lord, these things we do ask and pray in thy son Jesus' name with thanksgiving. Yes. And the saints of God says, amen, amen, amen. Amen. Amen.